tidy, that remarkable exchange in the House of Commons yesterday featuring Dawn Butler, the MP for Brent. The bad news is that Dawn Butler is only giving one interview today. The good news is she's giving it to us. So, Dawn, many thanks for squeezing us into to your schedule today. I begin with the obvious question. You knew you were breaking the rules when you stood up and said that, right?
Yes, I did, yeah. So, ridiculous rule, though, to be honest, when it's quite clear to everybody that's ever listened to the Prime Minister or read things that he's written that, you know, he has lied and disrespected Parliament on so many occasions. And I just thought, this is crazy. He should have come to the House yesterday and he should have made clear all the times that he's misled Parliament and he should have apologised, and he didn't do that.
What do you say to people who I'm sure we both encounter regularly who respond to situations like this and scenarios like the ones in which we currently find ourselves by saying, oh, all politics are liars, they're all as bad as each other? What made you feel that this particular episode was so egregious that you had to take such extraordinary action?
Well, not all politicians do lie, actually. And I think we have a prime minister that's quite powerful, evidently, but we're in this sort of post-truth era, this sort of Trumpism type era where the truth doesn't matter. And he's using that to his advantage, which he's done all of his life. But the thing is this, we are still in a pandemic. People are still lying. And these lies have consequences, grave consequences for a lot of people. You know, this prime minister, ministers do the same. They lie too, you know, literally caught with their pants down and nothing gets done about it. And it's almost like there's nothing we can do. We keep trying to highlight the lies, but he just brushes them off. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, they don't follow the rules. And if they have to follow the rules, they'll create a new rule. I know, let's create a new rule and let's say that it doesn't now apply to us. And he has the power to do that because he's the prime minister. And, you know, in a lot of ways, we are powerless in Parliament. And sometimes you have to break the rules in order to change the rules.
That's an interesting way of putting it. I'd wish it was satire if I were to suggest, for example, that he might take an old mate from the Bullingdon Club and put him in charge of ministerial standards. But of course, that was last week's news. So you're not exaggerating. I wonder whether you, you've mentioned other ministers. Have you been surprised by that, Dawn? Because I think a lot of punters outside Parliament don't realise that there's friendships across the chamber, usually. There's friendships. I think Michael Portillo, for example, is godfather to Diane Abbott's son, or possibly the other way round. But there's a degree of respect, there's a degree of decency, there's a degree of decorum. Is that gone, or is it just receding?
No, I think you'll still find that respect in select committees, for instance. Yes. I sit on the Science and Technology Committee, and we're very respectful and appreciative of each other's skills. But this is the problem. Like in the House of Commons, there's so many things being thrown at us at the moment. You know, you've got the Coronavirus Act 2020, you've got the police and crime sentencing, you know, legislation. All of these things are just being thrown at us, and they are damaging to our democracy, to the British way of life. And there was a time when ministers in particular and the prime minister were very honourable. If they broke the rules, they would resign. They would step down. If you've been caught with your pants down, you know, you would resign. Not defended by the person at the very top and say, well, it doesn't matter anymore. It's dangerous for our democracy. And there's so many things that's going wrong. You know, there's so many things that, you know, the corruption that has happened in this government over the last 18 months, the amount of money that has gone astray, billions of pounds, and people kind of now just say, well, we're going to write off £143 million. Wow, that's a lot of money to write off. Oh, we spent £34 billion on a test and trace system that doesn't work. Let's forget that. Oh, we spent money, you know, £1 million on ventilators. Oh, we gave a jeweller £73 million for PPE, which we haven't been able to use. This is ridiculous.
It's reported as well, of course, that Matt Hancock had used his personal email to conduct some conversations with people who may have ended up supplying the government. And we learned today that the government has decided that they're not going to scrutinise Matt Hancock's personal emails. Sometimes, I don't know whether you feel this, I do in my work, which is obviously nowhere near as important as yours. It's hard to know which thread to pull. So what was the breaking point for you? What was the kind of the pivot that prompted you to do what you did yesterday?
I think Peter Stefanovic, I hope I've said his name right, the CWU.
This is for people who don't know, this is a collection of calumnies issued by Boris Johnson, usually in the House of Commons, that have are now being viewed nearly 30 million times, but most corners of the, what we still call them, the mainstream or the legacy media have neither taken up his footage or his catalogue, or indeed done their own versions.
Yeah, and it's so blatantly clear. This is what the Prime Minister said, and this is the truth. You know, the Prime Minister uses things like "we're the best in the world" to kind of get people to be really sort of patriotic. Oh, we're the best in the world at test and trace, but we're not. That is a lie. You know, no other country had an app that was working. Yes, they did. Singapore, Germany, France. That's a lie. You know, we have severed the link between, you know, vaccinations and death and hospitalization. But that's a lie. So, you know, he says all of this stuff in a way that makes people feel good. He has this ability to make people feel better. But the fact is, if it's a lie, the consequences are extremely damaging. I mean, the health secretary, Matt Hancock, the previous health secretary, he didn't even visit the memorial wall for the people who have died from coronavirus. And he's the health secretary. You just think, not only have we got a government that's full of liars, but they're also heartless too. And I think as a government, I think as a country, we deserve better than that.
Finally, Dawn Butler, I don't want to be pessimistic, but you knew that you'd face sanction. That's it, is it? You just have to leave the chamber for the rest of yesterday. You don't, there's no further punishment.
Well, I had to leave the chamber and parliament, which I was like, okay, thank goodness I had my bag with me, because I had to leave straight away. Been escorted out.
Had your Oyster card handy, otherwise things could have got sticky. But I do worry that you've highlighted a problem that a significant portion of the population either doesn't care about or continues to ignore, and possibly doesn't even believe, despite the receipts and the evidence provided by you and people like Peter Stefanovic. This is something that perhaps the opposition, you can't control the media, but it is perhaps, I would say the media should be doing a hell of a lot more stuff like what you two have done, but the opposition should be doing more as well, no? How can they do that within the parameters of these rules that are designed to safeguard a system which, as you argue, the Prime Minister and his closest colleagues are treating with complete contempt? I suggested earlier that the rules that sustain the system, the basic standards of decency, have now become a millstone around the neck of politicians telling the truth about politicians who are not telling the truth. I don't see a way out of that. I wonder whether you do.
Well, this is the warped kind of Alice in Wonderland sort of world that we're living in, where the rules protect the lies. And it's very strange that, you know, we're in parliament, you're not allowed to say that the Prime Minister's lying when the Prime Minister is evidently lying. And so we do have, the rules are very antiquated, they are traditional, and they need to change, and we need to modernize, because we are the enemy that we're facing in terms of this twisting of the truth twisters. You know, we need the rules to accommodate and move and progress accordingly.
I know,
what needs to happen.
I know I said finally, but I'll just chuck this in if I may. There is an alternative, of course. We could return to the days when the most senior politicians in the land didn't ride roughshod over convention and tradition and standards. No, I mean, because the rules are pretty good. They've served us pretty well for hundreds of years. It's just that nobody foresaw the current regime, perhaps.
Absolutely. Let's all follow the rules. Prime Minister, you come to Parliament and deliver statements in Parliament instead of going to your mates in the press, in the media, delivering it then, and then politicians are secondary. You know, we are not secondary. We are elected politicians, and we're elected to serve our constituents in Parliament. But this government has tried to thwart that every step of the way. They tried to close down Parliament. They've given themselves Henry VIII powers. Democracy doesn't matter to them. You know, all they want is, you know, this unprecedented powers to do whatever they want, and they've been getting away with it for too long. But we are parliamentarians, and every single politician on all sides of the House should actually stand with me on this and say, well, this isn't our democracy, and we are fighting to take back control, James.
take your three-word slogan. Have you had any words of support from people on Conservative benches?
I had a few Conservative MPs come up to me and approach me. And the thing is that it's really interesting when it's a fight for democracy, no matter what side of the spectrum that you're on, you kind of meet in the middle when it's a fight for, you know, our freedoms, our rights, our democracy, the rule of law. You know, it's fundamentally British, and we are fighting for that together, no matter what side, you know, of the house we sit on. And I think that's really important. I've worked cross-party on, you know, vaccine passports. I've worked cross-party on holding the government to account in terms of, you know, the grab of our data, you know, and the misappropriation of our data. So when it comes to stuff like this, it's about what's right.
And it's the national interest, isn't it, I suppose, in the purest sense of the phrase.
Absolutely. And if we allow the Prime Minister to do this now, who knows who will follow him and what will happen next? We can't allow that sort of Trumpism to take over the UK. We just can't have it.
Dawn Butler, many thanks indeed. I'll tell you before you go, because I know you're busy, I haven't seen my inbox blow up with almost undiluted praise for a politician in an extremely long time. So please be aware of that as we bid each other farewell. And thank you once again for squeezing us into your schedule this morning. I won't tell my listeners which politicians you kept waiting in order to be able to talk to them, but we're all very grateful that you did. It's coming up to 11:15. You're listening to James O'Brien on LBC. That's big, right? I think Jonathan Aitken actually was Diane Abbott's godfather to Diane Abbott's son. Just clarification and correction. Always happy, as you know, on this program to provide that. But that was pretty huge, I think. And I have some sympathy for people in my line of work who just still don't get it. Not the ones who stick their fingers in their ears and close their eyes and start going la 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 la, or you know, have a little flag poking out of their backsides. I find it hard to believe, just as I did in America, how far and how fast we've fallen from the most basic conventions and standards. You know, how do you make sense of the fact that you live in a country now where a parliamentarian, an MP, can get expelled from the House of Commons for telling the truth about a PM who has lied in the House of Commons? Do you want to have a crack at that, or is that too much like a Rubik's Cube for a Friday, particularly when it's this hot? Find out after this. I can't remember the last time we did this. I'll play you a little bit of a clip from the House of Commons. We'll talk to the politician involved, in this case, Dawn Butler, the MP for Brent, and then just ask you what you make of it all. So just by way of a recap, this is what happened in the chamber yesterday.
Madam Deputy Speaker, poor people in our country have paid with their lives because the Prime Minister spent the last 18 months misleading this House and the country. Peter Stefanik from the CWU has over 27 million views on his online, and let me tell you some of them. He highlights that the Prime Minister said the economy has grown by 73%. It's just not true. Reinstated nurses' bursary, just not true. There wasn't an app working anywhere in the world, just wasn't true. Tories invested $34 billion in the NHS, not true. The Prime Minister said we have severed the link between infection and serious disease and death. Not only is this not true, Madam Deputy Speaker, but it is dangerous, and it's dangerous to lie in the pandemic. And I'm disappointed that the Prime Minister has not come to the House to correct the record and to correct the fact that he has lied to this House and the country over and over again.
Order. I'm sure that the member will reflect on her words. She's saying perhaps correct the record.
Madam Deputy Speaker, what would you rather, a weakened leg or a severed leg? You know, at the end of the day, the Prime Minister has lied to this House time and time again. And it's funny that we get in trouble in this place for calling out the lie rather than the person lying.
Order, 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 order. Can you please reflect on your words and withdraw your remarks?
Deputy Speaker, I've reflected on my words, and somebody needs to tell the truth in this House that the Prime Minister has lied.
Under the power given me by Standing Order number 43, I order the member to withdraw immediately from the House for the remainder of the day's sitting.
21 minutes after 11 is the time. What do we make of that? And I think, crucially, how have we ended up in a place where an MP gets thrown out of the House of Commons? I understand the rules, as indeed did Dawn Butler, does Dawn Butler. But what does it say about the country? How have we ended up in a place where you get thrown out of the House of Commons for telling the truth about a Prime Minister? who has lied to the House of Commons. Jessica is in Bristol. Jessica, what would you like to say?
Well, first of all, I commend Dawn Butler for actually sticking to her words, not being intimidated by the threat of being removed and, you know, quite publicly humiliated.
Do you think she was humiliated? She didn't come across as feeling humiliated, but I know what you mean. There was a risk involved, wasn't there?
There was a risk. There was a risk. And it was very much a case of, I'm going to publicly stand up to the Prime Minister about the fact that he hasn't told the truth about these things, regardless of the fact that I will be, you know what I mean, reprimanded. And you know what? It takes a lot, because people don't give politicians enough credit for when they do things which are, you know what I mean, are full of integrity, are honest. And Dawn Butler is an example of that. And what she was saying, if people want to Google it, those things are true. Those things are true. Just because
that's the bit where things get a little bit surreal, isn't it? Even as a journalist, you're sort of thinking, do I need to cover my back on this? Do I need to second guess that? Do I need to fact check that? And no is the answer. I mean, the most egregious probably being the scientists say the link between infections and hospitalizations has been severed, when we'd heard, I think, Chris Whitty say the previous evening that it hadn't been severed. It had just been weakened.
Oh, my gosh. Well, as far as I'm concerned, this is a really, really, you know, the idea of Trumpism, the fact that we're heading towards Trumpism where the truth doesn't matter, it creates a situation where people start to second guess themselves. People start to second guess themselves and second guess what's the best thing to do, because it seems like the truth doesn't matter, but it does. So people start to second guess themselves, and that allows for an environment where Trumpism does kind of like start to grow. So it's a battle. It's an ongoing, continuous battle. And I tell you something, I honestly, I empathize with Dawn, because I myself have been in a situation where I've been fighting for the truth, I've been fighting for justice, and have felt completely and utterly bamboozled by every single form of, you know, I mean, form of justice that there is. It hasn't been done. And I just think to myself, what do you do? How do you cope? How do you keep yourself motivated when it seems that everything is designed to stop truth and justice? And I think we as a country, we are heading towards injustice being the norm if we don't start tackling it now.
And in response to people who say all politicians are the same, all politicians are liars?
No, not at all. I'm sorry.
We need to remember, and people like me would do well to remember, that applies on all benches. There are, I don't want to say there are very fine people on both sides, because we're not talking about a Nazi riot in which somebody got killed. But I mean, they're thin on the ground now after the big cull at the end of 2019. But you know, Dawn Butler reminds us that these rules work perfectly when basic standards of decency are being observed by everybody in Parliament. The attraction to them today is built upon the fact that those rules are not being observed.
Well, the thing about it is she said that some of the Tory MPs came up to her and, like, commended her. I think that's really poignant. Because someone's on the other side, it doesn't mean that they immediately go party line, toe the party line, and they don't care whether or not it's the right thing or the wrong thing. There has to be we have to live in a society, we have to strive for a society that when it comes to certain things, you don't think about party line, you think about what is right? What is in the public's interest? Is this fair? Is this just? Because we as a country, we're very good at reporting on injustices in other countries.
Yeah, that's a good point.
We love to report on injustices in other countries, and, you know, what's happening in China with the Rohingya Muslims. Why don't we take a look at what's happening here? And this is a self-reflection point for everyone, even myself. What are you doing that is helping or hindering the situation? And constantly, I'm trying my best to be someone that is what I think a good citizen. And whenever I see myself slipping into, it's becoming too hard, I have to recheck myself and say, no, strive, keep pushing. Justice is important. Public interest is important. You cannot
keep your eye. There is truth, Jessica, and there is untruth. And if you can hang on to the truth, even if you are the only one, you will not go mad, which is a no doubt misremembered line of George Orwell's. But I found myself thinking about it today as we prepared to talk to Dawn Butler, because that sense of impotence that you describe, that sense almost of incredulity at the state of play, it's hard to sustain when, you know, the crowd all around you are still cheering the quality of the Emperor's clobber. 26 minutes after 11 is the time. Alan is in Newbury. Alan, what would you like to say?
The thing is, the rule at the moment is that MPs are protected by what they say, quite rightly. They can say whatever they like, and so they can speak against large vested interests like Amazon or Google or companies like that. And it's quite right that they can say what they want without fear of retribution. But they can't call another MP a liar.
No.
Now, if they could call other people's other MPs as liars, and that would lose its impact. It would be happening daily, and nobody would take any notice of it. And you'd get people that are liars calling the other side liars.
Yes.
Just because they can.
No, I mean there's an ineluctable logic to the rule, isn't there? That's the point.
That's right. The fact of the rule is there made what Dawn Butler did yesterday so much more, gives it so much more impact, because it's so unusual. And so, paradoxically, it's quite a good thing. The only thing that I can see that might be a way forward is that if an MP lies knowingly to the House, it should be illegal. They should be prosecuted under law.
Or have some better sanction for the Speaker. I mean, the tragedy, Alan, as I think everyone would agree, is that we've reached a point where we need to have a conversation like this. If the Prime Minister says something that is demonstrably untrue, that is provably false, there's always the caveat that it was a mistake, but there has to be a mechanism in place that corrects it. So I don't know about prosecution, because we've all said things on a Monday that have been rendered untrue by a Wednesday, and there's always a defence that we didn't realise on Monday that they weren't true. And we all make mistakes. But the idea that we now desperately need a mechanism that compels the Prime Minister to correct something said in the House of Commons that is irrefutably false, I mean, that is an astonishing state of affairs, isn't it?
Well, he's not going to like that, is he? Because you've only got to see the reaction to the print press when they're told they have to retract.
False statements. Put a falsehood on page one, put a retraction on page 212 6 months later.
Yeah, they're up in arms against it, and right and wrong is not important to them. It's going to take some thinking about. You're right, you can't just make it illegal. It's too simplistic, but it's definitely
no, but
well,
we need to find out. And how has it happened? Answer is pretty easy, actually. It's one thing on which most people would agree is because of the personnel that are currently installed at the top of the pyramid. Alan, thank you. And that's the bit I don't get, actually. Any constitutional experts who want to have a crack at how you actually deal with this problem, because the rules have become a problem for the politicians telling the truth. Rules designed to stop politicians from lying. And this is where those Trump parallels are absolutely irresistible. Rules designed to stop people from lying, politicians from lying, have become a problem for politicians who are telling the truth. And I don't know how you fix that. Well, I mean, I've got some rather unpleasant personal business to attend to now. I may have given you the impression that my colleague Keith and I enjoy a very warm and bantersome relationship, but I've just noticed that hashtag James O'Brien is a bully is currently trending on Twitter, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to check your phone, Keith, and then perhaps we could have a bit of a sit down and talk about how we could both learn from this experience, and ensure that it could never happen again. I mean, I have asked you many, many times to come directly to me with any issues or problems you may have. I told you about the gentleman in Leicester Square the other day from Birmingham, a gentleman of a bit older than you and I, who came up to me and literally thanked me for making the name Keith fashionable again. And here you are. But yes, And here you are now, starting hashtags saying James O'Brien is a bully on Twitter. It's awful. Although there is some good news. There is a huge silver lining to the fact that hashtag James O'Brien is a bully is trending on Twitter. I'm confident, looking at some of the people responsible for it, that there is, despite huge shortages in British supermarkets up and down the country, and of course the meat producing sector being particularly worried about massive shortages, there is no likelihood whatsoever of any gammon shortages in this country for the foreseeable future. So Keith, please see me after class. Back to Dawn Butler and her astonishing intervention in the House of Commons yesterday. Frank is in King's Lynn. Frank, what would you like to say?
Well, I mean, I was listening to Dawn Butler and, you know, yes, she used the word liar, which obviously is not good in Parliament, but she was absolutely bang to rights. It's so true. And we now have a Prime Minister with a massive majority who's becoming very, very authoritarian. And then using that authority to try and... He wants now to cut back the judiciary so that they cannot prorogue Parliament again like they did before. They're trying to bring in new laws to control the press, so the press trying to use Freedom of Information acts cannot get access to print stories. It's getting more and more like China, believe it or not. And I lived in China for 10 years.
Oh, good. I'm glad I didn't jump in then and tell you to wind your neck in, Frank, because you just dropped your qualification into the conversation immediately afterwards. We're a long way from being like China. The fact that we're conducting this programme, most obviously, Frank, in the way that we're conducting it, being fairly
absolutely
conclusive
proof. You haven't had people marching in and shutting it down, but
no.
What would it take for them to decide to do this? It's sometimes getting a little bit crazy in this country. And, you know, we've been thoroughly split.
Well, we have, and the split continues. And, of course, the fear that they need to keep the split burning is impossible to, or for me at least, impossible to resist now. So much of what they're doing seems designed, whether they're talking about footballers taking a knee or National Trust houses or dance troupes on Britain's Got Talent. But, you know, you said at the beginning that there's a sort of conundrum here, isn't there? Because it does feel, you said at the beginning, she said she used the word liar in Parliament, and that's not good. And yet, it's also necessary. It can be both at the same time, can't it? I really wish we weren't in this situation.
Yeah, would she have been allowed to say economical with the truth?
Possibly. Yeah, no, that was... I can't remember what that one was about. Was it Peter
that was,
Wright?
That was the spy book. Someone in Parliament.
I think
with the truth.
Economical with the truth. How do you see it ending? How do you see it playing out?
I think it's going to stir people up even more, quite honestly. We know that he's got his backside in a very big sling. He doesn't know which way to go. I'm also ex-forces. I would never want him as a commanding officer. He'd throw you to the wolves.
Well, that's a fairly brutal analysis. And I suppose that many of his former colleagues would probably agree with you. I mean, the ones that have been thrown to the wolves, but also the ones like Robert Jenrick and I can't even remember who it was on Tuesday morning, who were going around defending Boris Johnson in the studios, only to find that Boris Johnson had pulled the rug from underneath them while they were in the limousine home or in the chauffeur-driven car home. Frank, many thanks. Matt's in Shrewsbury. Matt, what would you like to say?
Hi, James. First time caller. Please don't pinch my dinner money.
Yes, all right, Keith. Thank you. What do you want to say, Matt?
It's just, first of all, Frank, I think hit the nail on the head there, your previous caller. Mm. He stole a little bit of my thunder. But yeah, it's just about how Boris has just stacked the cards, hasn't he? You know, his duplicitous positions that he adopts. Key appointments to his cabinet seem to be
there's always a little bit of not whataboutism, but the other lot did it too. So the BBC appointments, you could point out that when Tony Blair was Prime Minister, I think some of the plum jobs went to people who were Labour Party supporters or even Labour Party donors. So there's always a little bit of give and take, but the areas in which it feels unprecedented are probably the areas of barefaced lies. Even the dodgy dossier that they went to Iraq with, they'd convinced themselves it was true. The horrors that have followed, they didn't look us in the eye and know they were lying to us, like Dominic Cummings did in the Rose Garden and like Boris Johnson does almost every time he opens his mouth.
I mean, his performance at PMQs, I listen to your show most days when I can. And, you know, you listen to his performance. His performance, was it last week when they were talking about the players taking the knee? And yeah. You had Keir Starmer opposite him, literally reading articles and headlines and referring to dates.
Yes, exactly, of what he'd actually done and what he'd actually said.
And, you know, just finally as well, I mean, just... I've got so much admiration for Dawn Butler, especially as a person of colour in the current climate, to stand up and have the stones to bear, and to call him a barefaced liar in the House, which we've touched on, is unprecedented. But, you know, these people that we elect, they're supposed to be held to higher standards.
And who is going to do it? Who is going to do it? Is the question, isn't
it? Well, you would have hoped, even Lindsay Hoyle, I'd like to say it would have been nice to see Keir Starmer call him to task and hold him to account, but how Lindsay Hoyle allows him to... He has five questions to ask him every week, and he's lucky if he gets a straight answer to any one of them.
Again, I don't know what they can do differently. Burko sort of upset what you and I, in a sense, would probably call the right people, Lindsay Hoyle. It certainly doesn't seem to be lauded by either side, which is probably what you'd want from a speaker. But the sense that they are currently, the sense that Lindsay Hoyle is playing a game that has changed and he's still abiding, he's still playing it by the old rules, I do find increasingly hard to shake. Although, of course, it wasn't him in the chair yesterday. It was Lindsay Cummins, no G, who the deputy speaker to whom Dawn Butler addressed her points. Thank you, Matt. There you go. You can keep your dinner money on this occasion, but I'll be dangling you over the stairwell by your ankles on Monday morning. 41 minutes after 11 is the time. Trevor is in Camden. What do you think, Trevor?
Hi, James. Thanks for the heads up about the cheap gammon coming in the supermarket.
No shortages there, mate.
Absolutely. I'm just wondering where this, you know, absolutely full of admiration for Dawn Butler. At least it gives us some hope that there is some sort of spark of opposition somewhere in the parliament. But what I'd like to see, you know, is actually that this is maintained. And I would suggest, although they've broken up, but when they come back, that they carry this on. That every day, a Labour, or if Labour can bring themselves to collaborate with other parties,
yes,
maybe members from other parties, continue. So that every day, someone calls out the lies. Even if they have to leave the Parliament, you know, for a day at the moment, does that really matter that much? Because most of the business is done in them select committees. So as long as they do it when on a time when they're not in a select committee, that's fine.
Yes.
So why not? Why don't? Why
what
don't
about
they
the media
actually...
as well? It's a bit of a pet subject for me for obvious reasons, but the media really is a bit like America after 2017. There is this sense that they haven't quite. It's like they've changed the rules or they've changed the vocabulary of the game, and most of the media hasn't caught up with it yet because they never expected. You know, they said the American Constitution was sort of designed to keep someone like Donald Trump out of the White House, but once he was in it,
they couldn't get rid of him.
They didn't know what to do. There was nothing there that could protect them from somebody lying through their teeth to the entire world, not just the population or the country, to the entire world every single day. And I do feel, I've guarded against it, Trevor, because it feels like hyperbole, but I do feel that we're knocking at the same sort of door now.
Well, I do. No, I totally agree with you. I mean, I always said, you know, when Trump was in power, I called Johnson the mini-Trump.
But, yeah, I resisted that for a while. I resisted it for quite a long time, actually. Still a little bit of me resists it now, probably because I don't want it to be true. But how else do you describe it? How else do you describe that one line?
I didn't, James. I went in like the like Boris Johnson attempting to do a football tackle. head first. But anyway, but they need to build on it. They need to call them out. And that's the only way, because the press is owned by the people that support the Conservative Party. And if you like,
corporations which
advertise in these right-wing media journals are also the donor parties to the Conservative Party.
Yeah, well, we all need advertising. I can't feed my kids without advertising, so there's always a little bit of a balance and a trade-off. But I think what I was naive about was probably, you just said these newspapers, these... organizations, media organizations support the Conservative Party, but there's the brackets that I never really saw before, which is whoever they are and whatever they do, close brackets. That's the crazy bit, yeah. Isn't it? There's nothing wrong with supporting the Conservative Party, but when you're supporting slavishly a regime that is utterly detached from reality, utterly detached from the truth. We haven't even mentioned the blinking B word, Trevor. Trying to renege on a negotiation on a treaty that got them elected, they're now trying to claim that it... Oh, sorry, we did it by mistake.
You're preaching to the choir here, mate.
Clearly, I am. And of course, those not in the choir are too busy backing up Keith's disgusting hashtag on Twitter. The question really is... How on earth am I going to punish Keith? No, the question really is, have we ended up in a country where rules and conventions that are solid... This phrase, the good chaps theory of government, is one it's taken me a while to understand. I don't know how familiar you are with Nyrin Bevin's view of the Conservative Party. It's fair to say it was blistering. The word vermin is contained in one of his most famous quotes. And I'm a big fan of Nyrin Bevin, huge. But you... probably can't get much done in politics without recognizing that sometimes you have to take with you people with whom you don't agree. So the good chap theory of politics is that there is a shared commitment to basic standards and basic decency. So I find myself increasingly, not perhaps embarrassed, but yeah, all right, a little bit embarrassed by seeing everything in black and white terms, seeing everything as a little bit binary. Good guys lean to the left, bad guys lean to the right. And it's a stupid position to take because some of my best friends are right-wing, but or have right-wing views on issues that I don't have right-wing views on. But the mutual respect hinges upon the mutual observation of standards. You know, it's why you... I think it's why you have a convention in the House of Commons. It means you can't call... I think, didn't Dennis Skinner get thrown out for calling David Cameron Dodgy Dave and refusing to withdraw it? And Dawn Butler thrown out yesterday for calling Boris Johnson a liar and refusing to withdraw it. Now, Dennis Skinner now could probably make a case for having been proven completely right, but only by events subsequent to him calling David Cameron Dodgy Dave. Dawn Butler, I think, had an impregnable case yesterday. So the rule is there to stop you lying about people. That's the weirdest thing. You're not allowed to call an MP in the House of Commons a liar because they could be telling the truth. Do you see? It's a bit backwards, but I'm trying to get my head around it. You can't call an MP a liar because they could be telling the truth. And in order to make sure... That's it, yes. It's like a catch-all convention. So in order to make sure that no MP can ever call an MP who's telling the truth a liar, no MP is ever allowed to call an MP a liar. That's it. How can you ensure that no MP who is telling the truth is ever called a liar in the House of Commons chamber? Well, the only way you can be absolutely 100% sure of that is by having a rule in which no MP is ever allowed to call another MP a liar in the House of Commons chamber. And that's the rule that Dawn Butler broke yesterday, even though she was clearly telling the truth about an MP who is a liar. And I have resisted, if that's quite the right word, balked at comparisons to Donald Trump's complete disassociation of American politics from observable evidence, abetted by some corners of the media, but also not challenged by other corners because they just didn't... It's like being asking somebody who's only ever played football to suddenly start playing rugby. How the hell are we supposed to deal with this? And Dawn Butler came up with an answer yesterday, and I'm tempted to suggest, unless you've got a better answer, you should sit down. 11:52 is the time. Phil is in Cardiff. Phil, what do you reckon?
Morning, James.
Hello,
Phil. Yeah. I mean, when you quote words like vermin and liar,
yes,
you're typically talking about words that people wearing one football shirt might be ascribing to people wearing another.
Vermin, yes, but liar is measurable, isn't it? Liar is a testable accusation. Vermin is not. Quantifiable, that's the word.
Yeah, exactly. That leads me on to a suggestion that you see in other walks of life, you know, online sometimes and elsewhere, that there is something called a fact check process. And would it be beyond the bounds of Parliament to modernise itself to have an opening session on one day that just dealt with fact checking statements made the previous day? And if there were egregious errors, made by serving cabinet ministers, that those invoke a process of coming to the House automatically and accounting for the statement that was made and publishing
Well, this is what I want, bizarrely, Phil, this is what I want them to do on question time. I think at some point,
at some point,
we're going to have to recognise what we've done or what we've become, and you're not going to be able to take anything on trust. But I'm sure you, like me, feel that somehow, I mean, there's a great sadness in thinking that we need to do that to the House of Commons, that Britain is the mother of all parliaments.
And also the danger with, you know, some of the other erosions that are occurring. The danger is that it might be put in, you know, that very body or that very process every morning could be run by somebody from the Bullingdon Club or from a slightly impoverished judiciary or something like that, you know, that
yes.
they've been wounded before they start. And, you know, that is a worry, but I still feel... I think there's something on a Saturday morning with the BBC where they actually go back over the previous week and they say, okay, that was a bit out of order or whatever, you know. And I think it would give airtime to the really horrible stuff. And, of course, we have a head master of horrible stuff currently.
Yes. But would it be a reversible regular? So you bring in this department for fact-checking and then... It's there forever, you see, and that means forever. That,
but then
forever you've got this sense that they can't be trusted.
Well, you've got a sense that this is the House doing its own spring cleaning every morning.
Yeah.
And it therefore isn't.
But it is built upon a suspicion that they cannot be trusted, whereas at the moment I think we operate, or we have operated for a couple of hundred years.
I think it's not so much that you have to apologise for it. You, if you were to take a view that you regard this process as a custodian of integrity, you know, and moving with the times, then yes, it may have had its seed or origin in a time when trust had been eroded, but it nonetheless could stand the test of a process.
Yeah, I mean, you sound more sensible than most of the people in sort of top jobs.
Well, you're very kind.
Well, no, I just there's a pessimism involved in your analysis that I want to challenge but can't, because you've got all the evidence on your side, haven't you? We probably do need something like this, but I wish that we didn't.
The only problem with what I'm suggesting is it can't be stuffed full of football shirts. There has to be some...
And who do we trust to be? Who do... I mean, who can we trust? I mean, I wish it was a joke to say he's just brought a mate from the Bullingdon Club in to mark his own homework when it comes to the ministerial code. And then we'd reach for the kind of classic National Treasure cut type figures who wouldn't want to do the job in a million years, like David Attenborough or such, you know. Who would we?
And our two most senior legal members of the government ran to the defence of Cummings last year and so on.
Of course they did.
So they're questionable in terms of what you could call independent integrity.
Mm.
You know, I don't want to go too far, but clearly that was, they were being obedient to a
flag
message there.
An ideology, or not even an ideology, but they were, the football shirt analogy works best again, I think. Just kissing the badge, regardless of the facts and regardless of the evidence.
Totally.
Phil, you're a star. I really enjoyed that. And I suspect one idea might be for... parties to nominate politicians, former politicians, who had been members of parliament for other parties. So, you know, the Conservatives might nominate somebody they respected or admired. They might nominate Alan Johnson, I don't know, and the Labour Party might nominate Rory Stewart. You could perhaps put a panel together of people who were trusted by the political oppositions. I don't know. I mean, thinking out loud, the likelihood of any of this happening when there's a majority of 79 in the House of Commons for the fellow who is telling the lies is, to say the least, unlikely. Not just the fellow who's telling the lies, of course, but the fellow who has just put an old mate from the Bullingdon Club in charge of policing ministerial standards. It's coming up to 11:59. Continue with some of this, but I also want to have a look, or I think I do. I told you, didn't I, at 10 o'clock. Tensions between all the different definitions of importance. This feels like the most important story in town, but not in the context of our lived daily experience, in the context of our political reality. You know, the points that Dawn Butler has raised, the impact that she has had is of profound importance. Historically, you would say, getting food into supermarkets is of profound importance today. And the question of getting children vaccinated, younger people vaccinated, not children, that's a conversation for another day, is obviously of profound importance for a whole heap of obvious reasons. And I want to get into the vaccination question a bit, if we can. But I'm not ready yet to come away from the question of what it means to you to live in a country where an MP now gets thrown out of the House of Commons for telling the truth about an MP who lied in the House of Commons. We continue this question of what's going on. I know it's a little bit lazy of me and I certainly couldn't do it every day. But the intervention by Dawn Butler in the House of Commons was incredible. And I'm in that situation again where I expect you to get the world's smallest violin out, because I do want to introduce another strand of conversation, but it's going to be a struggle because the switchboard is groaning under the weight of people waiting to contribute to the current one. And it was listening to Nick's show this morning that I thought perhaps we need to strap our armour back on and return to the fray of vaccine scepticism, vaccine hesitancy, vaccine misinformation, particularly among young people, among many young people, that the numbers are a worry. Only I think up to a third of 18 to 29 year olds have not had any jabs at all. Which explains partly the drop-off. But this is the tightrope that we have to walk together. And I don't know how to walk it, to be honest with you. If you let people on who... Because what I do, I hear a name. So someone will speak to another radio presenter and they'll say a name. Why don't you consult the work of so-and-so? And I just put the name into Google with the words fact check. And I used to think that was a really reliable way of doing things. So something will come up saying, yes, that has now been revoked, that research has been disowned, or that individual is not who he claims he is, that person didn't invent that thing. But that just isn't enough, is it? So I had one the other day, and this oddly is not a criticism of the person involved. I think they asked me a question. I can't remember the full details, forgive me. I spend far too much time on Twitter as it is. But I can't believe what Keith just tweeted. That's absolutely outrageous, Keith. What are you playing at, mate? I thought we were all in this together. So I replied and I said, look, here is some evidence that proves that you're wrong. Here is Reuters fact-checking the thing you told me about a vaccine. And because the fellow that is chairman of Reuters is on the board of a vaccine company, that was a reason not to trust anything that Reuters said. So that you sort of sit there and you can see, I always say to you, there's a kernel of plausibility in these problems. They're not, well, all right, I don't know quite how the flat earth theory came to gather so much pace, but there's a kernel of plausibility. So yeah, I get that. You know, if you sort of are determined to end up where you started, you could just about say, well, I'm not going to trust anything that Reuters say about Pfizer, because a bloke who's high up at Reuters is also on the board at Pfizer. And I kind of see that. It's obviously nonsense, but how do you diffuse that nonsense? So that's usually my trump card. I guess I could have found a similar fact check that had been undertaken by a different organisation. I guess I could have found a full fact check, or a Channel 4 news fact check. But I imagine that they're susceptible to the same, or an LBC fact check. You know, we can do them ourselves. But I imagine that if you dig hard enough, and of course it doesn't have to be true. On this occasion, it was true. Chairman of Reuters is on the board of I think it was Pfizer. Forgive me, I should have got my ducks in a slightly neater row before coming on air with this. But it was one of the big pharma companies that is responsible for one of the vaccines. But it didn't have to be true. You could have just said it. And then I go on Facebook and I see friends, one in particular, who I can't touch, I can't reach. I tried early on to say, you know, that's me you're talking about. When you talk about mainstream media and is it scum journalists? Is that the phrase that they use? You know it's me that you're talking about. And you've known me since I was a kid. You know this isn't true about me. And they can't quite, it's, oh, no, 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 we don't mean you. And I said, well, you do mean me, because I report what Valance and Whitty are saying. I report what the scientists are saying, I don't report in the same breath or as a sort of false equivalence what you found on YouTube or what, well, we can all name these people, what they're saying. And the tightrope I'm talking about is addressing the problem without amplifying the problem. And I don't know how you do that. I really don't. If the simple fact check isn't going to work, then what is? 0345 6060973. I do not know, but you know, I said about a week ago, I'm very worried. Looking at America in particular, there was a story out of, I can't remember which state it was, it may have been Baltimore, about an ICU doctor who is incubating people who refuse to take the vaccine. And I mean, not taking the vaccine has become a sign of loyalty to Donald Trump. And they're going under, they're being intubated, and they're begging the doctor for the vaccine, and he says, I just hold their hand and tell them that it's too late now. And I think we're kind of going down that road here a bit, albeit that there's more of a generational skew, and I don't really know who the major cheerleaders and architects are for the misinformation and for the anti-vax nonsense. Should I even call it nonsense? I don't know. The minute you start editing and policing your own language and not saying things you believe to be true because you're worried about the impact that they may have, usually we're on a slightly rocky road. And then, of course, the Dawn Butler conversation about trust and leadership, or the connotations it throws up about trust and leadership becomes or begins to feel really, really urgent. So how do you do it? Yeah, that's a question, all right? How do we get 18 to 29-year-olds to get jabbed? How do we do it? 0345 6060 973. Hit the numbers now, you will get through. Freed up a few lines, so apologies if you were waiting to talk about Dawn Butler and dishonesty. We'll take a few more calls on that, but I want some fun. How do we do it? Let's just have a think together. I don't think that I want to have a big row with you if you're persuaded by what you're finding on the internet. And some of the, I really would urge you to look at my podcast from last week with Dr. Catherine Green and Professor Sarah Gilbert, who were the architects of the AstraZeneca vaccine and who have written a whole book designed to assuage, and it's written with warmth and even perhaps with love, designed to assuage and to address the misinformation that is being spread about their own work. So they feel it a lot more keenly and a lot more urgently than even I do or you do. But listen to that full disclosure from last week. I must give you a quick mention actually about who's the guest this week, but I don't want to distract you from where we are heading next on the show. The really simple question of how do we as a society get more 18 to 29-year-olds to get the jab. And I know that excludes you from the conversation if you're absolutely adamant that you're not going to get it. But I think that's probably the responsible way forward, you know. I probably wouldn't let you ring in if you were going to tell me why you were furiously opposed to safety belts in cars. I just don't know what is gained from it. It's not like Brexit. It's not fun to pull your pants down in public or to render you ridiculous by asking you to explain what it is you've ended up believing. I don't think that achieves anything in the context of a vaccine, because if you don't take it, you increase the risk to me and mine, and you increase the risk to everybody, to an entire society. So how can we together get more people in that age group particularly to get jabbed? I mean, crikey, you should know that there's something serious going on when I find myself in full agreement with the Daily Mail. It'll change our DNA. We can't get COVID. Big Pharma can't be trusted. The tests were rushed. Some of the beliefs that have seen jab rates stall among the 18 to 30s, all dismantled here by an expert. Obviously, the Mail's not going to add that the denigration of experts is something that they contributed more to than any other organ in the land under their last editor. You'll remember Michael Gove telling you that the country had had enough of experts, but better late than never. And they add, pin it on your young skeptic's bedroom door. And that's another way into it. Tell me about your children. Are you frustrated by your own children's vaccine hesitancy, vaccine skepticism? And maybe by telling us a little bit about what it's like to have it in your own home, we can nudge together towards that place where we come up with some good ways of of dealing with it. Chris is in St. Leonard's. Chris, what would you like to say? Back to Dawn Butler for a couple of calls, and then after quarter past, we'll wade into the vaccine controversy, the vaccine conversation. So back to Dawn Butler and dishonesty. What made you pick up the phone?
Hello, James.
Hello.
Thanks for having me on the pod.
Very, very well.
I understand that you want to try and move on from the Dawn Butler thing, and I think. No.
You're talking about the Dawn Butler thing. We'll move on in 5 minutes or so. Don't worry. I'm not gonna ambush you like that.
No, but I think there's a common thread.
Go on then.
And I haven't found up with a fully formed solution. It's more thinking out loud.
Mate, I have never presented the program with a fully formed theory or solution. So don't feel bad about that. Whatever you do.
Well, I share my position is I share a lot of your sentiments and those of other callers. Truth is absence. It's a crisis. I love David Miliband's expression, the age of impunity.
Yeah.
And people in positions of power and authority do what they want. They game the circumstance. They take the hit and move on and so on and so on and so on and so on. I think the answer to the question about vaccination is the same as the answer about truth in Parliament, is it comes down to the opposition, it comes down to the political process, and at the current circumstance, it comes down to Labour to press the point on exactly the matters that keep consistently coming up about the Prime Minister's lack of integrity, and try and focus attention on the tens of millions of people in this country who don't give a damn. They're quite content with the idea that the Prime Minister is a liar. They're quite content with the agenda that forced Brexit was built on completely unreliable facts and statistics and so on, because it suits their perspective. And I think maybe it's time for media focus to turn towards those people who seem to be happy to live in, I don't know, a dishonest world, a reality that has no
foundation. It's hard to see how that happens until the lies affect them directly. And we're back to that Martin Niemöller poem, aren't we? I know it's always a little bit risky to cite the rise of the Nazis in the context of any conversation about politics, but that simple premise of I'm not fussed about what they're doing because it's not affecting me directly. First they came for the residents of St. Leonard's, and I didn't do anything because I didn't live in St. Leonard's. And then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak up for me.
But I'm not sure that I agree with you completely. But I'm not sure that for the people who voted for Brexit, who voted for this Conservative government, I'm not sure that they'll get it. I'm not sure that.
Ever. So what do you do in the meantime? Just sit it out, wait it out, sweat it out? I don't know.
I think a joint effort between the political process.
I think you need conservatives, actually. You need conservatives to stand up and say, I don't want to be part of this anymore. And of course, that would involve surrendering power. And that, to take it back to America, is why so many Republicans are now pretending to believe the big lie, because they need Donald Trump's endorsement in order to cling on to their jobs in the Republican Party. So it's
America's
ugly.
Where we're headed. The Republican Party is providing the route map for the Conservatives.
Again, I used to resist that conclusion, Chris. I used to, because I'm frightened of it, I think. I'm not embarrassed to use that word. It's frightening to think that it could happen here. But if it can happen in America, then the likelihood that it could happen here increases exponentially. It's not like Hungary or China, as an earlier caller mentioned. It's the land of the free, ostensibly. Chris, thank you. You made me a little late for the break. It's the only reason we're leaving.